Good morning. It's especially good to see everybody here because this is one of those summer weeks the pastors talk about that is vacation weeks. And my phone rang off the hook this week with, you probably won't see us for 2 weeks. We probably won't be there for 2 weeks. We're going away. And I'm very excited about everybody that's going away for vacation until you get the feeling as you're writing your sermon and getting everything finished that you might be preaching to about five people. So then when you see everybody that's there, you're like, hey, that's awesome. So thank you, and please be praying for all those who are out traveling and on the road, that they have a good time, and good weather, and safe, and because you just never know. I heard about some people that were somewhere and went out in the water just to have fun, and sharks started biting on them. And, so you just never know. That's why you pray for people. I do have to share a funny story with you before I get started, because I appreciate all your prayer time. On Sammy going to college, Sammy's a real homeboy. He loves being at home. When we go on vacation, he's the kind that when he gets home, when you open the door, he gets down and kisses the floor because he's home. And so going and living at college is going to be really crazy on him. And then he found out that he can't come home from college. They have this great program. I wish that I could go back and do it, to be honest with you. They, when you go down to the school, they automatically get you, when you're in the ministry, they get you a job in the church. And this year, Sammy will work 10 hours a week in the church. And the next year, he'll work 15. And then his junior and senior year, he'll work 20, and he'll actually get paid. And they put you on staff at the church. And if you've grown up in a church your whole life under 150, they put you in a mega church. If you've grown up your whole life in a mega church, they put you in a church under 150 because they want all their ministry students to learn that all churches are important. I think it's an incredible program. I think it's fantastic. And Sunday mornings are going to be a time that Sammy will be at work. He'll have to go to the church to serve. So he won't be able to come home. So I'm really nervous and praying hard about his roommate. So we get swimming yesterday at Hannah's apartment. And we got to eat. We're driving home last night. And Sammy gets a text. And it's his roommate. And it's a young man named Ben from Southern Indiana. And so his roommate, they're chitting and chatting about being in the ministry and all this stuff. About what Columbus, Ohio is like compared to, this young man lives in Southern Indiana, so for fun, he hangs out in Louisville. And he's telling how much there is to do in Louisville and everything. And so Sammy gets that text, he's been scared to death. Do you like music? I love music. What kind of bands do you listen to? Well, Sammy's just like his dad. As you well know, our music doesn't fit that well into ministry circles. Because Sammy's going to be the rock and roll preacher junior. And so Sammy's very shy. He's like, well, Dad, should I put Rich Mullins? Should I put Chris Tomlin? I said, put who you are, Sam. You are who you are. So Sammy chickens out and puts, what kind of music do you like? And so Ben from Southern Indiana responds, my two favorite bands are Led Zeppelin and Black Sabbath. And Sammy's grin goes ear to ear. My two favorite bands are Led Zeppelin and Pink Floyd. He says, well, I'd like to learn more about Pink Floyd. Sammy texts, I'm just the guy to teach you. And from about 6 o'clock last night till midnight, Sammy and this kid are texting. It's just awesome. And this kid's a sophomore, so he can teach Sammy the ropes, all that stuff, so it's very exciting. But I appreciate your prayers and ask that you continue to pray, because as a dad, I'm very nervous about sending him off on his own to live in Cincinnati for a year. He's so close to that stadium where them stupid Bengals play, it's terrible. Sending him with a whole bunch of Browns wear. But anyway, today what we're going to talk about is what we've been talking about. Our sermon today is called Prove It To Me. But we're going to talk about a thing that people struggle with. Is the Bible still relevant today? When you read the Bible, do you see yourself in the people in the Bible? Because the thing is that people don't change. Times change. Technology change. People don't change. They're the same basic people that have been here since the beginning of time. And I hope that as you read the Bible, that you see that. That you see that people are the same. And so the things that happen in the Bible are still relevant today. And it is a tough thing that we deal with. And as we do this, we're going through and we're talking about, I've been talking about each week, this is part of, young people have to deal with me being a little bit old this month in this series. Is there was a guy that used to be on the news every night named Paul Harvey. And he used to do this thing called In the Rest of the Story. He would tell us a news story. They would break for a 60-second commercial. I believe it was an insurance commercial. And then they would come back and he would tell the rest of the story. And it was always kind of like a surprise twist ending. And so that's what we've been doing this week, or this month, and we will consider to continue today as we talk about Prove It To Me. And before we go into God's Word, let's pray. God, we come to you today knowing that we're the same people that were alive 2,000 and further years back. And so the stories that we read in the Bible are stories about us. And who we are and what we do. And help us to learn from that so that we can be more of who you are. The Bible is a book of hope. It's a book of good news. And you did so many great things for the people in the Bible. And Lord, we just want you to live like them and to be like them. And we know that all times have been bad. There have been all kinds of things going on since the world began. But you've always been there. Since day one. Help us to learn this and to live a life that glorifies you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to talk today about a story of a church. I'm going to tell you about a church, and this is a true story. The church just boomed. I mean, it started in 1964 as a mere church of about 25 people. And the next thing you knew, by the early 1990s, they moved up to a couple hundred people. And God continued to bless them through the 90s to where they actually grew to right around 500 or 600 people a week. And it was just growing and growing and growing. And you can imagine the elders, because the sanctuary was fitting 600 people, but a lot of people had to love each other enough to sit on each other's laps. I know you're all good enough to do that. Oh, yeah? And so anyway, they grew and they grew and they grew. And they started having those elders meetings where they were talking about, we need to split services. Because we're going to have a couple services just so everybody can find a place to sit. Well, the church started, you know, not really liking that because, you know, I don't want to sit, you know, miss going to church with this family, and we've went to church with this family for 20-some years. What if they start going at the 10 o'clock service and I'm at the 8 o'clock service? I don't want to do that. I'm going to miss these people. So everything was going kind of crazy, and everybody was praying about it. And all of a sudden, the minister went to bed one night. And about 1:30, 2 o'clock in the morning, the minister's in the middle of this dream. And he gets up, and he goes to his kitchen table, and he gets a bunch of big paper that his kids have, and he draws plans to a building. Now, the amazing thing about it is this minister has never had any training, never had any building sketches, engineering, any kind of training, and he draws this building. And he tells the elders, I think God has sent me the money, or the dreams of the church. And the elders are kind of, that's crazy. That's just nuts, you know, it's just something that happened. And so one of the elders has some money, so out of his own pocket, he takes the plans to an architect. The architect looks at him and says, I don't know why you need me, you've already been to an architect. Here's the plans. He says, no, this wasn't drawn by an architect. This was drawn by our minister who has no training in architecture at all. So they take these plans, the preacher, they tell him, the elders, they tell him the whole story. And the elders say, no, we don't have the money. We still owe $150,000 on this building. So this all happens in January. So one of the elders looks at the other elders and says, I've got an idea. He says, I've been praying about this. Let's go to the church and tell them the miracle. And let's ask them to increase their giving to where we not only keep our tithes and offerings that we need, but more money comes in so that we can pay off the building. Easter Sunday, they had a huge, huge party celebration because not only did offerings go up in that time and people went up, but they paid off the building. $150,000 extra from January to April. They paid off the building. So the minister went to the elders and he says, God is really working on this. God is really moving on this. He's doing great things. And the elders looked at him and said, we don't have any land. And there's no money to go out and buy the land. So everybody in the church starts praying. And do you know that in 2 months, somebody comes into the church, and this is one of those cities that has a major interstate through it, but has a circle around it, like 270 here. And a family gives $2 million worth of farmland right beside an exit off of the beltway around the city. Oh, yeah? How many people see God's hand? Raise your hand if you see God's hand in all this. And the elders came back and said, it's just not time. No. And we'll come back later to the rest of the story. But before we complete that, I want to tell you the story of a twin. And the reason I say the name of, it's the story of a twin, is we're going to talk about Thomas. Thomas is kind of a funny name in the Bible, and we hear it today, we don't think much, but in Greek and Aramaic, both, the word Thomas means twin. And we don't know much about Thomas's brother in the church, if he had a twin brother, but a lot of theologians make the joke and say the reason that Thomas, that God has his name Thomas, is he's our twin. He's my twin. He's your twin. Because Thomas is known in all biblical circles as the doubter. Oh yeah? And we live our lives like that. We live our lives doubting and struggling. And in John 20, 24 through 25, it says, although Thomas the twin was one of the 12 disciples, he wasn't with the others when Jesus appeared to them, so they told him, we have seen the Lord. Now, a little history on Thomas. Thomas was very brave because a lot of people read this section of scripture and they think that Thomas was cowardly. And Thomas was not cowardly because we know there's a very famous scripture that when Jesus says we're going back into Jerusalem for Passover, the disciples all think Jesus is nuts. And Thomas looks up and says, if he wants to go to Jerusalem, then let's go die with him. Okay? Now that's a pretty brave statement. Now, most of us would walk back into town knowing that death probably surely awaited. And Thomas says, let's go die with him. So we know he's not a coward. We know that he loved Jesus. Thomas was a disciple that cared a lot about Jesus, was very affectionate towards him, thought that he was the Savior, believed in him, thought that everything was fantastic. And then as they had walked together, Thomas had seen Jesus do many, many miracles. He had watched him heal the sick. He'd watched him feed 10,000. He watched him raise the dead. He had been with Jesus through all of those different things. But you know what? He had not seen the risen Jesus. And I tell you, no matter what you can see people do, it's pretty hard to believe that somebody's going to raise from the dead. Oh yeah? Now that's the thing about remembering that you're a person and that these people were people. Because no matter what he had seen Jesus did, Jesus do, excuse me, I'm really having trouble talking about it. No matter what he had seen Jesus do, there's no way he can raise himself from the dead. There's no way God's going to do that. I can't believe that. I watched him die. I watched how terrible it was. I watched him crucify. I saw all those things. There's no way that he's going to raise from the dead. And we can relate to that because we have seen people healed of cancer. Oh, yeah? But when our friends get cancer and stuff, where does our minds go? Oh, they're going to die. They're going to die. There's no way they can get through that problem. Oh, this is just horrible. It's all over for them. God can't fix that. You ever hear Christian friends say that kind of stuff? And they do. And Thomas says in 25b, but Thomas said, first, I must see the nail scars in his hands and touch them with my finger. I must put my hand where the spear went into his side. I won't believe unless I do this. Thomas says, show me. Everything that Thomas had seen, he could not believe that Jesus would raise from the dead. And this brings us to something that is very common in our lives. There is a big difference between belief and doubt. A lot of people who believe in God and believe in Jesus have doubt about their situations. Oh yeah? Have you ever experienced doubt? Have you ever asked the church to pray for you about something? But it's more like a crutch, more like a, I'm going into this, it's really scary. I'm going to roll the dice and ask the church to pray for me. Or, I might even get all crazy and ask them to anoint me with oil for healing. Okay, I might get nuts and do something like that. I'm not sure if it'll work, but I'm going to just kind of hinge my bet. And see, that's the doubt that comes into us. Everybody believes in Jesus. And then you go to the hospital and people believe in Jesus and they want you to pray, but they just don't know if they're going to get better. People go into the doctor and the doctor says, you got 6 months to live. And I can't tell you through my 21 years of ministry how many phone calls I've got, Pastor, is there really a heaven? Well, yeah, you know there's a heaven. Yeah, but it's a whole lot different when you know you're only going to live up until. Because if there's not, I'm in big trouble. What's going on? What do I do? Am I ready? Is it going to be okay when I get there? Is it, and all of a sudden, that doubt creeps into our lives. And it's one of Satan's greatest tools. Satan knows that he's not going to really be able to get you to not believe in God. The statistics show us how many people have nothing to do with Jesus, nothing to do with God, but they believe in God. You can go out there and talk to them and they believe in God. I have shared with them before the story cracked me up in Portsmouth. I went into the grocery store and this guy comes up to me and says, hey, you're the dude that's preaching at that Central Baptist. I said, yeah, that's me. Well, I know I'm going to heaven. I said, well, that's great. You know, because I was just trying to pray for my groceries. And he said, yeah, I put my daughter on the bus every Sunday morning, and I figure he'll give me some leniency for that. And I said, well, you ever want to come yourself? No, that church stuff ain't for me. But I get my daughter on the bus. And you know, there's a whole lot of people out there that believe in God. But when it comes down to where the rubber meets the road, The sad thing is that there's a lot of doubt there. And that's where strong faith comes in. That's where reading our Bibles help us. Because in a relationship with Jesus, there has to be trust. 26-27, it says, a week later, the disciples were together again. This time, Thomas was with them, and Jesus came in while the doors were still locked and stood in the middle of the group. At that point, I need nothing else. The doors are all locked, bolted, because they're all afraid of the Roman soldiers, and there's all of a sudden Jesus standing in the middle of the room. He greeted his disciples, and then he said to Thomas, which lets us know a couple things here. God knows everything we think and say, right? Because Jesus wasn't there when he said, unless I see the nail scars in the spear's side, in the spear's side. He greeted his disciples and said to Thomas, put your finger here and look at my hands. Put your hand into my side. Stop doubting and have faith. Stop doubting. Jesus again gives him proof, and he's there to see that. But his words are words to come on for thousands of years as time rolls on. Stop doubting and have faith. When things are bad at home, pray about it. Believe that God can fix it. Stop doubting and have faith. When you see the news every day and it gets you all depressed and you're all down, stop doubting and have faith in what God can do. People say, oh, it's just going to get worse. It's just going to get worse. It's just going to get worse. You know, life's so terrible. Oh, what's it going to be like for our grandkids? Oh, stop doubting and have faith. Do you believe that God is in control? Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God and He's with you? Do you believe you have eternity? Stop doubting and have faith. John 20:28, Thomas replied, you are my Lord and my God. And you know what? In the presence of Jesus and in the presence of God, it's really easy to say. And that's what's great about church. Church is the place that we come and we can say, you are my Lord and my God amongst many, many believers. Isn't it good? I looked at the kids the other night in youth group. And I asked them that tough question. I said, what is the Bible? Because I'd read about a very famous singer who said a quote that the Bible is a book to prove how moronic we are and how perfect we are. And I wanted to get their answers to what the world thinks the book is. And when they're in church, they just can't give the answers the world says about the Bible, right? Everybody knew, said, it's the truth. It's the Word of God. It's the, you know. Those are great church answers. Oh, yeah? But we live in a world that thinks that the Bible is a rule book. It gives no hope. And we have to teach them who that is. And so what we have to do is we have to learn to have the answer, you're my Lord and my God, when Jesus isn't standing there. And see, to do that, we have to ask Him to remove doubts. Now let's go back to the rest of the story. The rest of the story on the church that I was telling you the story about, with all the miracles that happened and everything, the elders finally called a meeting and called the minister in and said, We're just going to tell you, we built this church in 1964 with our own hands. It's a great building. We don't need a new place. This is wonderful. God will work it out here. We're not doing anything. Within 16 months, they went from 600 to 200. So guess what the answer was? Anybody want to guess? They fired the pastor. They called the pastor in and fired him. And in the last 20 years, they have went from 200 to under 100 to where they really struggle. I think they're on their seventh pastor since that happened. Almost every one of the elders who originally said no have either died or moved to other churches. they don't go there anymore. And it's a really sad story, because had there been faith and had there been understanding Jesus, where would they be today? Might be one of the mega churches that we talk about with 15 or 20,000 people. Oh yeah? God had a plan. He was moving in another direction. He had it on a beeline. And they said, no, because Jesus hasn't walked in here and told us. Because I'm going to tell you, I knew all those elders, and if Jesus would have walked in and told them, they would have done it. But just seeing the signs and hearing the things and knowing God's word and matching things up wasn't enough. They needed more. And that can be our life. We can struggle. We can need more. Just seeing the things that God has done, knowing who He is, sometimes it's not enough for us. Because we let that doubt creep in. And when that doubt creeps in, we don't stand a chance. And we have to learn to fight against that. You know, Thomas died for Jesus. You know, we think of him with this doubt, but how much, you know, when you read in history what they say happened to Thomas, they believe that Thomas was stabbed by a spear while planting a church in India. When you think about the disciples, you don't think about India, do you? You know, that's a missions trip from the 1700s or something. Thomas went to plant a church in India, and as he was working, somebody stabbed him to death with a spear. There's a lot of love for Jesus in that. A lot of confidence to take off and go to a different country, go to a foreign land. And he had seen the risen Jesus. But what do we do? Can we go on the stories that we've been told? Can we go on the scriptures that we've read? Can we go on our faith and seeing the things that Jesus has done? Because there's a special scripture for our generation and the generations that are to come. And that's John 20:29, which says, Jesus said, Thomas, do you have faith because you have seen me? The people who have faith in me without seeing me are the ones who are really blessed. Don't you love that scripture? Those who have faith without seeing me are the ones who are truly blessed. It's our generation. A few generations before us, the next generations to come, we haven't seen Jesus. But we've seen evidence of Him. We see it in our lives every day. We see it in how things happen that we pray for. We see how things go that we pray for. The other day, I'm telling you, I don't know if anybody else feels this way, but what a miracle to see that soccer team get out of the cave. So yeah?
Right.
How many people around the world are praying? I mean, people who really don't have a relationship with God were torn up and were praying about those kids getting out of there. And they get out of there. And I tell you, I don't know about the rest of you, but I watched a thing that they showed the way they had to swim out of there. And the little gap they had to crawl through and everything, they would have had to say, leave him, he's dead, about me. I couldn't have got through that little thing, I don't think. But you know what? God is good. And He gives us all kinds of promises about if we pray, what He'll do. He tells us that we're never alone. I get people come and see me and they say, I'm so alone. It's so sad, it's so depressing, I'm so alone. And you know what? There's that learning that God is always with you. That Jesus is always there. You're never alone. But to get that feeling, you have to remove doubt. You have to believe He's always there. He says, whatever we ask for will be given to us. Do you trust Him? You trust that you have faith and believe that everything you get? I mean, I've heard all kinds of answers about that. I've heard, we know we really prayed for him to be healed, Pastor, and you told us that scripture, whatever we pray for will be given to us. I prayed really hard for my mom and dad, and I watched them enter the kingdom of heaven. What a blessing. I'm just jealous because I'm stuck here. Oh yeah?
Oh yes.
We can't wrap our arms around that. Instead, we want to get mad at God.